What do you want to be when you grow up? Was a question that troubled me in my childhood. It caused a lot of confusion and especially a lot of frustration. Growing up, did you all face the same question? What do you want to be when you grow up? Now the problem with this question is, it assumes that I am nothing today. And as I grow, as I age, I will gain experience, I will gain skills, I will gain expertise just by growing up. And therefore, we need to do away with this question and start asking our students a modified version of this question. And the modified version is, what do you want to be today? And when I ask these questions, what do you want to be today? I get amazing answers from the students. Some say, I want to start a funeral management service. Some say, I want to start liquor delivery in 30 minutes. And some say, a discounting app. Some say, I want to be a YouTube superstar. The answers are amazing. And please note, they don't talk about a profession. They all talk about ideas. Ideas they want to execute. Ideas they want to take from idea to today impact. And I'm very thankful that students talk about ideas, because it is exactly ideas what we need today. The All India Center for Technical Education has released a report which clearly says that out of the 8 lakh engineers that we produce year on year, more than 60% of them are unemployed. And if this statistic doesn't baffle you, please note, I can produce more such reports for all the industries. Jobs are getting scarce. People are just not finding employment anymore. Technology is replacing those who are maybe rudimentary, who are doing mundane, repetitive tasks. At the same time, the private sector has people on benches and it wants to lay them off. And it's not just the private sector that's laying. The largest employer in India, the Indian Railways, the Indian Army, are offering voluntary retirement packages. Therefore, the grass is not green on either side. Now, India is a youthful country, right? Our politicians, our industrialists keep boasting how 50%, more than 50% of India is youth, of how we are going to harness this youth potential, but I really don't see that happening. What schemes do we have? What leverages are we doing for our youth? Absolutely nothing. I have friends who have done their undergrads and postgrads from beautiful institutions and are working at entry-level jobs for peanuts. Isn't this a criminal waste of our youth? Isn't this a criminal waste of their life? Isn't this a criminal waste of their time? I strongly feel so. And what is the answer to this? The answer is, if there are no jobs, let's create a mind shift. Let's create a change in all our students. Let's make them job creators than job seekers. Now, entrepreneurship, like I said, is the answer. How do you take this to students? Can you take entrepreneurship? Can you teach entrepreneurship to students? What do you think? I don't think entrepreneurship can be taught. It's a skill, and therefore, to bring industry to the classroom will take a lot of time if you want to go the syllabus route. And you know how long it takes. Therefore, the only answer to this is to get industry professionals in the classroom, teach them the reality. We need to teach our children that it is good to be romantic about your enterprise, but also be realistic at the same time. By profession, I'm a lawyer. I'm a corporate lawyer, and I deal with a lot of entrepreneurs, small and big, starting up to scaling up, and I have a whale of a time when I do that. As a part of my work, I also give talks, like the one today, on idea generation, on intellectual property, on funding, on how to become investment ready, and so on and so forth. And after a talk, a teacher friend of mine walked up to me and said, Kunal, I loved the talk. I would like you to repeat the talk to my students. And when she mentioned students, I naturally assumed postgraduate students, B school students, MBA students, or at least graduate students. Now, before going, it's very important to know the audience profile, and that is why I asked her, can you give me a background on these students? And she said, these students range from 8th standard onwards to people who are just starting their graduation. Now, this was a shock, and I was reluctant to accept this. And I kept asking her, are you sure that you want me to repeat this same talk to these students? Don't you want me to dumb it down, to simplify it, to make it more digestible? Are students interested in entrepreneurship? She said, we'll find that out. Just come and give the same talk. And I said, fine, let me give it a shot. I walked into the classroom, and it was a Saturday. It was November 2014, I distinctly remember the day. And as soon as I walked in, I saw these students happily chatting away, having a ball of a time, and I felt very sorry for them that they're going to hear a 1 hour lecture on entrepreneurship. I'm going to spoil their Saturday. I started speaking. I told them three things that day. I told them how to come up with an idea. When you come up with an idea, how to express that idea. Once expressed, how to put that idea into a model. How to commercialize and value that idea was number one. Number two, I said how to create a business model out of it. And number three was how to test this idea, whether the market really wants it. Or if just created something cool, something to talk about, is the market will never pay for. And I shared the relevant links with them where they could read. I shared the various formats with them where they could go and fill later. And it was a good talk. And usually, after a good talk, I've always seen there is this adrenaline rush. There is this newfound ideas. There's this burst of ideas. There is so much energy and enthusiasm in the crowd. Everyone seems to have some concept or the other. They want to meet you. They want to come and talk to you and discuss their enterprise. And it's usually this way. But I've often seen that motivation, like Mark Twain rightly said, is like bathing. You need to do it regularly. You need to do it daily. And the same thing I've observed in seasoned entrepreneurs, age 30 to 40 and 60. But something strange happened that day. Out of the 50 students who were in the classroom, around 30 of them actually showed up in the week after the talk. They showed up at the office. And they did not just show up. They showed up with their business models completely filled, their ideas completely explained, and with they would answer my questions. And I was initially dumbfounded, but then I was impressed. And I said, I'm giving these children a soft corner. Let me challenge them and let me forget that these are students. Let me ask them real questions. And when I started challenging their model, when I started challenging their idea, I told them the realities of it. The business model developed cracks and they became a little underconfident. And a lot of them went back. Out of these 30, the third meeting or the second meeting was done only by 10 of them. What happened to the rest? Did they drop it? Yes. They called me up and they said, sir, you were right. The points you pointed out the other day, we have dropped the idea because of that. We understood that that's a fatal defect, not a curable defect. The others said, we need more time to come and work on the idea or come and reply to you. But most of them did start. Now, every story has a villain. And who was the villain in this case? Whenever I work with entrepreneurs, the villains are usually lack of capital. People don't have the requisite funds. They don't come from a business family, a wealthy family. How will they start up? This is a very common villain that I come across. Something else would be they don't have the necessary expertise. They're students. How will they have expertise? Or something like they don't have the relevant experience to start. They don't have mentorship. They don't know much. These are the usual answers that I come across, usual villains. But in this story, the villain was actually the parent. At the third meeting, when the parent actually showed up, we had small talk earlier, and then the parent asked the child to actually go and wait down, do something, but just to leave us to talk. And then the parent said something which really baffled me. I was appalled. The parent said, Kunal, what are you doing? Why are you sowing these vicious seeds of entrepreneurship in the minds of our child? He keeps talking about his idea day and night. I don't know what's happening. He said, we are a middle class family. We are service people. We cannot fund his enterprise. How is he going to take off? We want our child to settle fast, to get a secure job, to manage himself, to manage us. And that's not going to happen through his enterprise. I don't know how it's going on. When they mentioned this, I was really hurt. I was very humiliated. But then better sense prevailed and I started talking to the parents. I told them the worth of their child's idea. I told them it is not you who needs to fund the child, but there are investors out there. I told them how certain people are already interested in the business venture. I told them, your child, the I told I've got so many professionals on board and validated their child's idea. And it is only then when the parent realized, I don't have to do much for my child, is when the parent gave the green signal. That is when I realized, as a parent, the best contribution that you can do to your child's growth or to his dreams is to give him the gift of non-interference. Your child does not need your expertise. He does not need your funds, not your experience. Your child needs your belief. He needs your trust. Just tell him, I'm there with you, go ahead, I believe in you, and your child will fly. Now, out of these 10 who started, do you think everybody flew? The answer is no. Entrepreneurship is a thorny journey. It's not as easy as it looks. And therefore, 4 of them survived. And they survived how? One of them is employing 3 employees at the lowest. The biggest one is employing 22 employees, paying salaries, making money for themselves, supporting their family, growing some organically and some exponentially. This is when I realized these kids have moved from Spearmints to today's Spearminting, and not just Spearminting, systematic minting. They've identified a model to do this. And I was very happy. I went crazy. I went completely berserk. And I started. So whenever you understand there is a model that is working, you should start repeating it. You need to start replicating it. And this is exactly what I did. The first talk, the first picture that you see is of the first talk I gave in 2014. If you see, these were the students out of whom the 10 started. Subsequently, I gave talk at private colleges, at my Institute of Company Secretaries, followed by a lot of other institutions which welcomed us with open hands. And I remember a quote which is said by Mr. L.E. Lecoq very beautifully, that no single person can whistle a symphony. You need an orchestra to do it. And I knew that if this symphony needs to go loud, needs to be strong, I need to build an orchestra. And I built a team of industry professionals who could bring this industry to the classroom. Absolutely. And it's working like anything. If you see, this was an incident that we did in Jalgaon, which had a beautiful response. We went to Tata Institute of Social Sciences. We had come to your institution as well during Mantrapreneur. And the journey continued. Recognizing our work, we were also invited by the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports to come and talk to their people, to their representatives. We did an exclusive thing for artists, where we taught artists that it is not just important to create, but also to create a business model so that you are not living paycheck to paycheck, so that it becomes a system-driven process, a process-driven process. The Vishranthwadi police station at Pune also encouraged me to do a lot of sessions for them. So you can see in the lower picture, you can actually see a police officer standing there and supporting us. We did private workshops, and of course, everybody supported us like anything. It is then I realized I had more fun in working with children than I ever had working with adults. Children, this beautiful, fertile mind, are bustling with ideas. The levels of their energy, enthusiasm, and their inclination to take risk is far, far higher than an adult can ever have. They tell me, sir, today I don't have a family, I don't have a responsibility, I can do whatever I want. He says, I want to learn, I want to fail at this enterprise, I can get a job very easily. This is the youth we need to build. This is the attitude we need to cultivate in our students. And until we do this, how do we leverage our youthful country, our future of India, as they say? And therefore, as a child, I always loved a saying that when you see a person hungry, don't give him a fish, but teach him to fish. I don't believe this. I don't agree with this. I say, don't just teach him to fish. Teach him the fishing industry in general, so that he does not fish to eat, but understands how much to eat, how much to sell, creates a model around it, a sustainable model, creates an employment around it. This is exactly what we need to transform India, to change India. And therefore, I always believe that the startup world and the entire entrepreneurship culture is bogged by a lot of myths, by a lot of half-truths, and frankly, with a lot of darkness around nowadays. But Let's not be the people who curse the darkness. Let's be the candle and spread light. And if being a candle is too difficult, at least be a mirror that reflects light. If what I have spoken to you today, what I have shared with you today, and what my team and I have done connects with you on any level, I request you to join us. Just drop in a hi at that email ID. We will train you. We will make you ambassadors. Our orchestra will grow and our symphony will just grow louder. Please help us in catching them young and creating the creators. Thank you so much.